Subject is computer graphics. Subject code is CA567. And this subject has is taught in MCA fifth semester. Today we will discuss what is computer graphics, what are the different applications of computer graphics, what are the input and output devices that we use for the application of computer graphics. So what is computer graphics? It is the technology for presenting information. It is the branch of computer science which mainly deals with the formation, manipulation, storage and display of the image, adding additional information and graphical effects such as shading, tilting, filling of colors, morphing, etc. Now the functions of computer graphics. The first function of computer graphics is creation of object by taking the data from input coordinates or by freehand or specific input from keyboard. So these are different inputs that user can take. Now secondary is scanning from existing drawing. Now it can also scan from the existing drawing. Manipulations such as correction, modification, changing shape, size, color, etc. And the fourth one is production. That is the mainly printing and plotting. Now the characteristics of computer graphics. Interactive nature and preview capability of computer processing systems. It is computer graphics provides joy, adventure in the form of cartoon movies and video games. High resolution displays. To run the package, it requires proper training. The final picture displayed is the net result of creativity inside the human beings. So it is all about creating a new object onto the screen. Now the applications of computer graphics. There are a lot of applications where we will discuss few of them. First is building, design and construction. It provides very useful tools for generating architect drawings and visualizing structures. Computer can make various images of buildings from different angles. So for that we use 3D graphics. Next one is electronic design. The design of PCBs were earlier done by hand, but nowadays engineers work on the video screens and designs the PCB and generate hard copy output for further reference. So that is the new application of electronic design. Next one is mechanical design. As machines are simply complex arrangement of mechanical parts, constructive solid geometry techniques is used to design different parts of the computer using graphic software. Now the computer graphics has its application in entertainment and animation. As we already know, there are a number of cartoon animation movies are on display these days. So it is another application of computer graphics. Aerospace industry. Computer graphics has an application in aerospace industry also. Aircraft designers use computers to simulate the airflow over wings. The air pattern around the wings are displayed on the graphics monitor. Simulated software are also used to train the pilots. Now, simulated software are also used for training the bus drivers, pilots. That is possible with the help of computer graphics. Now, computer graphics has also application applied on medical technology. Computerized axial tomography used to compose the three-dimensional model of the brain by taking multiple X-rays of it. Computer graphics has also applied on cartography. Computer graphics is used to produce accurate and schematic representation of geographical and other natural phenomena from measurement data. For example, graphics maps, oceanographic charts, weather maps, population density maps, etc. Now next application is in the field of arts and commerce. Computer graphics is used to produce pictures that express a message and attract attention like teleshops, transportation, hotels, etc. Now the display devices. We will start with the display devices. What are video display devices? Video monitors are the primary output devices in a graphic system, and the operation of these monitors is based on standard cathode ray tube design, that is a CRT design. So the first display device that we'll discuss is refresh cathode ray tube. As you can see, this is the basic design of a magnetic deflection CRT. It is having the heater. This is the cathode. This is the control grid. Then we have the focusing coil here and here. These are the deflecting coils. Now these are the fluorescent screen. Now how will it work? Where this heater is generating an electron beam and it is falling on the fluorescent screen on a particular location. A spot is generated at that particular position. So this is the way how electron beam generate a particular spot. Like this, every time when it wants to, generate a spot on this fluorescent screen, in that case electron beam will point to that particular position. So this is the way of how it works. Now a CRT is an evacuated glass bottle with a heating element on one end and a phosphor coated screen on the other end. When a current flows through the heating element called a filament, the conductivity of the metal filament is reduced to the high performance, high temperature. A beam of electrons or cathode rays emitted by an electron gun passes through focusing and deflection system, and that directs the beam towards specified position on the phosphor coated screen. The phosphor then emits a small spot of light at each position contacted by the electron beam, but this light fades very rapidly. So therefore, to maintain the picture on the screen or to keep the phosphor glowing, we can redraw the picture rapidly by quickly directing the electron beam back over that same point. This type of display is called refresh CRT. Now electron gun in CRT consists of two parts. First, the heated metal cathode. Second, a control grid. The intensity of electron beam is controlled by setting voltage levels on the control grid, which is a metal cylinder that fits over the cathode. The CRT is refreshed to avoid flicker at least 60 Hz. But exact number depends upon the image intensity, ambient lighting and wavelength, size of the screen. Now the focusing system in our CRT is needed to focus the electron beam to converge into a small spot. As it strikes the phosphor, otherwise the electron will repel each other and the beam would spread out as it approaches the screen. So focusing is accomplished with other electric or magnetic fields. Electrostatic focusing is commonly used in television and computer graphics monitors. Additional focusing hardware is used in high precision systems to keep the beam in focus at all the screen positions. So these are the few terms you must know. First one is persistence. Now what is persistence? Different kinds of phosphors are available for use in CRT. Besides color, a major difference between phosphors is their persistence. Therefore, persistence is defined as how long the electrons continue to emit light after the CRT is removed. We can further define persistence as the time it takes the emitted light from screen to decay to one tenth of its original intensity. Lower persistence phosphors require higher refresh rates. The graphics monitors are constructed with persistence range of 10 to 60 microseconds. Now, second term that we usually use is resolution. Now, what is resolution? The minimum number of points that can be displayed without overlap on a CRT is referred to as the resolution. The resolution of a CRT is dependent on the type of the phosphor, the intensity to be displayed, and the focusing and deflection system. The typical resolution of a high quality system is 1280 by 1024. The high resolution system are often referred to as high definition systems. The resolution is measured in terms of number of scan lines, the number of pixels per scan lines, and the number of pixels bits per pixel. The ratio of vertical points to the horizontal points necessary to produce equal length lines in both the directions on the screen is called aspect ratio. Aspect ratio is equal to percentage means vertical lines with 3 points is equal in length to horizontal line of 4 points. Now second system is raster scan display. Raster is an acronym for matrix. In a raster scan system, the electron beam is swept across the screen one row at a time from top to bottom. As the electron beam moves across each row, the beam intensity is turned on or off to create a pattern of illuminated spots, refresh buffer or frame buffer. The picture definition is stored in a memory area called refresh buffer. This memory area holds a set of intensity values for all screen points. Stored intensity values are then retrieved from the refresh buffer and painted onto the screen one row at a time. Now this is the diagram for raster scan display. As this is the electron beam, when electron beam will strike, it will go by line by line, row by row. So it will scan from left to right, and then it will come to next row from left to right like this. So if suppose it want to generate this triangle, so what it is doing in the second row onwards, it will find out that this pixel should be on and the rest of the pixel should be off. So it is scanning horizontally, and in the last, when it will come to an end, it will come to the upper left corner of the screen. Now it is well suited for realistic display of scenes and television sets and printers. In black and white systems, each screen point is either on or off. So only a bit per pixel is needed to control the intensity of screen positions. But additional bits are required to display variations in color and in intensity. In black and white systems, frame buffer is called a bitmap, whereas for systems with multiple bits are known as pixmap. Refreshing rate. Now what is refreshing rate? The frequency at which the content of the frame buffer is sent to display monitor is called the refreshing rate. There are two terms that we will use is horizontal retrace and vertical retrace. Now what is horizontal retrace? The return of the electron beam to the left of the screen after refreshing each scan line is called horizontal retrace. For example, in this case, it is going from this scanning from left to right, then it is coming again to the left and then right like this. So this is called horizontal retrace. What is vertical retrace? At the end of each frame, the electron beam returns to the top of the corner of the screen to begin the next frame. That is called the vertical retrace. Now what is interlacing? On some raster scan systems, each frame is displayed in two passes using an interlaced refresh procedure. Pass 1. In the first pass, the beam swaps across every other scan line from top to bottom. In pass 2, then after the vertical retrace, the beam sweeps out the remaining lines. That means if in the pass 1 it has scan line 0, 2, 4, 6, 8 like this, then in pass 2 it will scan 1, 3, 5, 7, 9 like this. So interlacing helps us to see the entire screen displayed in one half the time it would have taken to swap across all the lines at once from top to bottom. So what is the advantage? The advantage is it is an effective technique for avoiding flicker, providing that adjacent scan lines contain similar display information. Now this is the architecture of simple raster graphics. In this we have the system bus and all the CPU, system memory, video controller, monitor, and IO input output devices are connected through this system bus. So now we can see the working of this. Now what is the role of video controller in the architecture? It is a special purpose processor in an interactive raster graphics system. It is used to control the operation of display devices. The frame buffer can be anywhere in system memory, and the video controller access the frame buffer to refresh the screen. After cycling through all the scan lines and pixels, video controller resets its registers to the first pixel position on top of the slide. To increase the speed of the process, a block of pixels is processed at a time. Now third one is telegraphic or random scan displays systems. Now in random scan display unit, the CRT has the electron beam directed only to the parts of the screen where a picture is to be drawn. That is the first difference between the raster scan display and the random scan display. In case of raster scan display, we were scanning all the lines, whether the picture is there or not. But in case of random scan display, the electron beam will be directed only to the parts of the screen where a picture is to be drawn. There are also called vector or stroke writing or calligraphic displays. The component lines of a picture can be drawn and refreshed by a random scan system in specified order. A pen plotter operates in similar way and is an example of random scan display. We can take another like example of random scan. When we want to draw a picture onto the page, then we use a pen or pencil, then we draw on that particular position only. So that is the example of random scan. Now refresh rate in random scan display depends upon the number of lines to be displayed. Picture definition is now stored as a set of line drawing commands in an area of memory referred to as refresh display file or display list, or we can say the display program or refresh buffer. This is a diagrammatical representation of random scan display. As you can see, we want to draw this this triangle. So either we can start from this position. So we will plot this line, then this line, then this line. So it has not scanned all the lines. It is drawing that picture on those particular. Drawing that picture on that particular position only. So that is your random scan display. Now, according to the commands in the display file, each component of the line is drawn and system cycles back to the first line command in the list. Now, random scan systems are designed to draw all the component lines of a picture 30 to 60 times per second. It is designed to line drawing applications and cannot be used for display realistic shaded scenes. Now you can see the difference between raster and random scan display. In case of raster scan display, it scans pixel by pixel, whereas random scan display scans line by line. In raster scan display, the picture definition is stored in the memory area, that is called frame buffer, whereas in case of random scan, it is called display program. Now in case of raster scan display, every time a picture is drawn, the whole screen is refreshed, whereas in random scan display, the picture drawn is only the area where the picture is drawn is refreshed. Now, in case of raster scan display, it requires more memory or time, whereas random scan display requires less memory and less time. It has lower resolution, whereas random scan has higher resolution. Now, raster scan display generates zigzag motion of the picture, whereas random scan display a smooth image. Now next one is color CRT monitors. A color CRT monitor displays color pictures by using a combination of phosphors that emits different color types. By combining the emitted light, a range of colors can be generated. Now there are two basic methods for producing color displays. First one is beam penetration method, second one is shadow mask method. Now, in case of beam penetration method, random scan monitors use the beam penetration method for displaying color pictures. In this, the inside of CRT screen is coated two layers of phosphors, namely red and green. A beam of slow electrons excites only the outer red layer, while a beam of fast electrons penetrates red layer and excites the inner green layer also. So there are two layers on the phosphor. What is there? One is the red one and another one is the green one. So it depends on the intensity of the electron beam that which layer of the phosphor coated screen will be generate the excited, which layer will be excited. So now what are the advantages of this beam penetration method? It is less expensive, whereas there are two disadvantages of this method. First one is quality of images are not good as comparable with other methods, and the four colors are allowed only. So when we are using red and green combination of the first one for screen, then only four colors are generated. Now in second method is shared mask method. Now raster scan systems are used this method to produce a much more range of colors than beam penetration method. In this, CRT has three phosphor color dots, that is for red, green and blue. So one phosphor dot emits a red light, second emits a green light and third emits a blue light. This type of CRT has three electron guns and a shadow mask grid, as shown here. This is the screen. So here, when this electron gun current is passed through this electron gun, so in that case what will happen, you can see here, if the electron gun for only this green gun is electron current is passed, in that case only green dot will be appear. So when these three electron guns have different intensity, then a combination of these intensity, that color spot is generated at the screen. So delta red shadow mask method is commonly used in color CRT systems. The steps in shadow mask methods are: the three electron beams are deflected and focused as a group onto the shadow mask, which contains a series of holes aligned with the phosphor dot patterns. When the three beams pass through a hole in the shadow mask, they activate a dot which appears as a small color spot onto the screen. We obtain color variations in shadow mask CRT by varying the intensity level of the three electron beams. Now it has its own advantages and disadvantages. So advantages are, it produces realistic images. Also it produces different colors for the images and the shadow scenes. Now the disadvantages are, it produces low resolution images, it is expensive, electron beams are active to the whole screen. Now in case of full color systems, these monitors use shadow mask method and take the intensity level for each gun. RGB color system with 34 bits of storage per pixel is known as full color system or true color system. Now next one is DVST. DVST is direct view storage tubes. It is an alternative method for maintaining the image. To maintain a screen image, the information is stored inside the CRT instead of the refreshing screen. So till our CRT monitors, we were storing the image definition in the frame buffer, whereas in case of DVST, it is stored inside the CRT itself. So storage grid, it stores the picture information as a charge distribution just behind the phosphor coated screen. Now there are two electron guns that we use in case of DVST. Our first one is primary gun that stores the picture pattern, and the flood gun which maintains the picture display. This is a diagram for DVST. Now it has this connector pins. This is the base, this is the primary gun, this is the focusing system. Now it has two guns. This is the flood gun and this is the primary gun. Now this primary gun is generating electron beam, and this is the phosphor coated screen. This is the collector here and this is the storage grid here. So it has its own advantages and disadvantages. Now the advantages of DVST are, it can let the picture display for a long time, refreshing is not required, very complex pictures can be displayed at very high resolution without any flicker. It is good for static picture only. It has flat screen. Now the disadvantages are, it is not suitable for dynamic images, do not display colors. To make a small change in picture, there is a need to redraw the entire picture. Now next one is flat panel displays. Now what are flat panel displays? It refers to a class of video devices that have reduced volume, weight and power requirement compared to a CRT. They are thinner than CRTs, and there are two categories. First one is emissive, second one is non-emissive display. Now what are emissive displays? These are the devices that convert electrical And what are non-emissive displays? These are use optical effects to convert sunlight or light from some other sources into graphics patterns, for example LCD. So that we use in our houses. Now what are plasma panels? They consist of two plates and are constructed by filling the region between two glass plates with a mixture of gases, that is a mixture of neon, xenon and or helium. This material is sensitive to light and the frame buffer, power refresh buffer stores the pixel array. Now what are the advantages of these flat panel displays? Refreshing is not required, but it produces a very steady image, totally free of flicker, less bulky than CRT, available in black and white as well as color displays. It is light in weight, it can be hanged on a wall, we can wear them on wrist also. Selective parts of the image can be erased or updated. Now, plasma panels also have their disadvantages. Refresh rate is only 60 bits per second, so not suitable for animation. They are slow devices, costlier than CRTs, and it also requires complex addressing and wiring. Now, as we have seen the emissive and non-emissive displays, so what is LED? LED is light emitting diode. It is a type of emissive device. Matrix of diode is arranged to form the pixel positions. Picture definition is stored in refresh buffer. Now what is LCD? LCD is liquid crystal display. A display technology that uses rod shaped molecules that flow like liquid and bent light. Unenergized, the crystals direct light through two polarizing filters, allowing a natural background color to show. When energized, they redirect the light to be observed in one of the polarizers, causing the dark appearance of crossed polarizers to show. The more the molecules are twisted, the better the contrast and viewing angle. Now, reason of replacing LEDs with LCDs that we are doing in our real life, because it takes less power to move molecules than to energize a light emitting device. LCDs replaced the light emitting diodes in digital watches in 1970s. LCDs were the widely used for myriad of monochrome displays and still are. In the 1990s, color LCD screens caused sales of laptop computers to explode, and in 2003, more LCD monitors were sold for desktop computers than CRTs. Now, this was all about our output devices. Now, we will discuss the input devices. Now, what is the input device? It is a piece of computer hardware that is used to enter and manipulate information on a computer. Now, the basic input devices are keyboard, mouse, digitizer, trackball, touch screen, light pens, microphones, barcode readers, joysticks, scanners, and voice systems. So we will discuss all these input devices one by one. The first one is keyboard. So the keyboard is the most common input device for entering numeric and alphanumeric data into a computer system by pressing a set of keys, which are mounted on a keyboard, which is connected to a computer system. The keys on computer keyboards are often classified as, some are alphanumeric keys, means letters and numbers, punctuation keys like comma, period, semicolon, and so on, and some are special keys like function keys, control keys, arrow keys, caps lock key, and so on. Now, next input device is mouse. A mouse is a small device that a computer user pushes across a desk surface in order to point to a place on a display screen and to select one or more actions to take from the position. Now, a mouse, what are the different parts of a mouse? A mouse consists of a metal or plastic housing or casing, a ball that sticks out of the bottom of the casing and is rolled on a flat surface. And it also has one or more buttons on the top of the casing. It has a cable that connects the mouse to the computer. Now, nowadays we use optical mouse, so we do not have that cable, the fourth part. Now, as a ball is moved over the surface in any direction, sensor sends impulses to the computer that causes a mouse responsive program to reposition a visible indicator called a cursor on the display screen. The positioning is relative to some variable starting place. Viewing the cursor's present position, the user readjusts the position by moving the mouse. The most conventional kind of mouse has two buttons on the top. One is the left one and another one is the right one, and we frequently use the left button. Now next one is digitizer. As you can see, the image of a digitizer. It is a graphics tablet that computer and also an input device that allows one to hand draw images and graphics. It is similar to the way one draws images with a pencil or paper. Now these tablets may also be used to capture data or handwritten signatures. A graphics tablet consists of flat surface upon which the user may draw an image using an attached stylus, a pen-like drawing apparatus. The image generally does not appear on the tablet itself, but rather it is displayed on the computer monitor. Some tablets, however, come as a functioning secondary computer screen that you can interact with directly using the stylus. Some tablets are intended as a general replacement of a mouse as primary pointing and navigation device for desktop computers. Now, next one input device is light pen. As you can see here, the image of the light pen. A light pen is a pointing device shaped like a pen and is connected to a visual display unit. The tip of the light pen contains a light sensitive element which when placed against the screen detects the light from the screen, enabling the computer to identify the location of the pen on the screen. Light pens have the advantage of drawing directly onto the screen, but this can become uncomfortable and they are not as accurate as digitizing tablets. Now next one is touchscreen. Touchscreen we use in our daily life in ATMs. What is a touchscreen? A touchscreen is a display which can detect the presence and location of a touch within the display area. The term generally refers to touch or contact to the display of device by a finger or hand. Touchscreens can also sense other passive objects such as stylus. However, if the object sense is active, as with the light pen, the term touchscreen is really not applicable. The ability to interact directly with the display typically indicates the presence of touchscreen. So, the touchscreen has two main attributes. First one is it enables one to interact with what is displayed directly onto the screen. Where it is displayed rather than indirectly with a mouse or touchpad. Secondly, it lets one do so without requiring any intermediate device, again such as a stylus that needs to be held in the hand. So such displays can be attached to a computer or as terminal to networks. They also play a prominent role in the design of digital appliances such as the personal digital assistants, that is PDA, satellite navigation devices, mobile phones and video games. Now next one is image scanners. Now what is a scanner? A scanner is a device that optically scans images, printed text, hand drawings or any other object and converts it to a digital image. Common examples found in offices are variations of the desktop scanner where the document is placed on a glass window for scan. Now, handheld scanners are the devices that are moved by hand and have evolved from text scan. There are 3D scanners also. These are used for industrial design, reverse engineering, test and measurement, gaming and other applications. Mechanically driven scanners that move the document are typically used for large format documents where a flat bed design would be impractical. Now, there are different types of image scanners that are available. First one is modern scanners. Modern scanners use charge coupled devices, that is CCD, or a contact image sensor, that is CIS, as a main sensor. Whereas older drum scanners use a photo multiplier tube as the image sensor. Next one is a rotary scanner. It is used for high speed document scanning, and it is another type of ground scanner using a CCD array instead of a photo multiplier. Third one is planetary scanners that take photographs of books and documents. Now we have 3D scanners also that are used for producing three-dimensional models of objects. Next one is digital camera scanners. Now these digital camera scanners are based on the concept of retrographic cameras. Due to increasing resolution and new features such as anti-shake, digital cameras have become an attractive alternative to regular scanners, while still having disadvantages compared to traditional scanners such as distortion, reflection, shadows, low contrast. Digital cameras offer advantages such as speed, portability, gentle digitizing of thick documents without damaging the book spine. Now, new scanning techniques are combining 3D scanners with digital cameras to create full color photorealistic 3D models of object. Now, next one is voice systems. Now, what is a voice input device? A device in which speech is used to input data or system commands directly into a system. Such equipments involves the use of speech recognition processes and can replace or supplement other input devices. Some voice input devices can recognize spoken words from a predefined vocabulary. Some have to be trained for a particular speaker. Now, speech recognition is also known as automatic speech recognition or computer speech recognition. It converts spoken words to a machine-readable input. For example, to key presses using the binary code for a string of character codes, the term voice recognition is sometimes incorrectly used to refer to speech recognition, when actually referring to speaker recognition, which attempts to identify the person speaking as opposed to what is being said. So confusingly, journalists and manufacturers of devices that use speech recognition for control commonly use the term voice recognition when they mean speech recognition. Now next one is joystick. As you can see the image here, that is the image of a joystick. It is an input device consisting of a stick that pivots on a base and reports its angles or directions to the device it is controlling. Joysticks are often used to control video games and usually have one or more push buttons whose state can also be read by the computer. A popular variation of the joystick used on modern video games consoles is the analog stick. The joystick has been the principal flight control in the cockpit of many aircraft, particularly military fast jets, where center stick of or side stick location may be employed. Now, joysticks are also used for controlling the machines such as cranes, trucks, underwater unmanned vehicles. Miniature finger-operated joysticks have been adopted as input device for smaller electronic equipments such as mobile phones. Now next one, the trackball. So this is the image of a trackball. As you can see, a ball inside that casing. A trackball is a pointing device consisting of a ball held by a socket containing sensors. To detect the rotation of the ball about two axes, like an upside down mouse with an exposed protruding ball, the user rolls the ball with the thumb, fingers or the palm of the hand to move a cursor. Large tracker balls are common on CAD workstations for very easy precision. Before the advent of the touchpads, small track balls were common on portable computers where there may be no desk space on which to run a mouse. Some small thumb balls clip onto the sides of the keyboard and have integral buttons with same functions as mouse buttons. The late 1990s replacement of mouse balls by direct optical tracking put track balls at a disadvantage and forced them to retreat into niches where their distinctive merits remained more important. Most trackballs now have direct optical tracking, which follows dots on the ball. As with Most networks now have an auxiliary device primarily intended for scrolling. Now next topic is output devices. So we will discuss the hard copy devices. Hard copy devices are the output devices accept data from a computer and converted them into a form which is suitable for user by the user. Now basic output devices includes monitor, printers and plotters. We will discuss these devices one by one. Now the first one is printers. Printers are most commonly used output devices for producing hard copy output. The various types of printers used today are as follows: dot matrix printers, inkjet printers, drum printers and laser printers. Now the dot matrix printer. You can see the image of the dot matrix printer. A dot matrix printer or impact printer is a type of computer printer with a print head that runs back and forth or in an up and down motion on the page and prints by impact, striking an ink-soaked cloth ribbon against the paper, much like a typewriter. Unlike a typewriter or a daisy wheel printer, letters are drawn out of a dot matrix and thus varied fonts and arbitrary graphics can be produced. Because the printing involves mechanical pressure, these printers can create carbon copies and carbonless copies. Now the each dot that is produced by this dot matrix printer by a tiny metal rod, or that rod is also called a wire or a pin, which is driven forward by the power of a tiny electromagnet or either directly or through small levers facing the ribbon and the paper, is a small guide plate with holes to serve as guides for the pin. Now the moving portion of the printer is called the print head, and when running the printer as a generic text device, generally prints one line of text at a time. Most dot matrix printers have a single vertical line of dot making equipment on their print heads. Others have a few interlinked rows in order to improve dot intensity. Now the inkjet printer. Inkjet printer form characters and images by spraying a small drops of ink onto the paper. As we can see the difference between the dot matrix and the inkjet printers. In case of dot matrix, it was striking on the paper, whereas in case of inkjet printers, it is spraying the drops of ink onto the paper. So the inkjet printers are the most common type of computer printers for general user due to their low cost, high quality and output, capability of printing in different colors and ease of use. Now the dots are extremely small, so small that they are tinier than the diameter of the human hair. The dots are positioned very precisely with the resolution of up to 1440 by 1720 dots per inch, that is DPI. The dots can have different colors combined together to create photo quality images. Now next type of printer is laser printer. It is a type of printer that utilizes a laser beam to produce an image on a drum. The light of the laser alters the electrical charge on the drum wherever it hits. The drum is then rolled through a reservoir of toner, which is picked up by the charged portion of the drum. Finally, the toner is transferred to the paper through a combination of heat and pressure. This is also the way copy machines work. Because an entire page is transmitted to a drum before the toner is applied, the laser printer are sometimes called page printers also. There are two other types of page printers that fall under this category of laser printers, even though they do not use lasers at all. One uses an array of LEDs to expose the drum, and the other uses LCDs. So once the drum is charged, however, they both operate like a real laser printer. Now, one of the chief characteristics of laser printers is their resolution. How many dots per inch they lay down? So it depends on the DPI, that is dots per inch. The available resolution range from 300 dpi at the low and to 1200 dpi at the high end. By comparison, offset printing usually prints at 1200 or 2400 dpi. Some laser printers achieve higher resolution with special techniques known as resolution enhancement. Now the laser printers produces very high quality print and are capable of printing an almost unlimited variety of fonts. Most laser printers come with a basic set of fonts called internal or resident fonts, but we can add additional fonts in one of the two ways. Now next up to device is plotters. What is a plotter? Plotter is a printer that interprets commands from a computer to make line drawings on paper with one or more automated pens. Unlike a regular printer, the plotter can draw continuous point-to-point lines directly from vector graphics files or commands. So plotters were the first type of printers that could print with color and render graphics and full-size engineering drawings. As a rule, plotters are much more expensive than printers. They are most frequently used for CAE, that is computer-aided engineering applications such as CAD or CAM. Plotter consists of an arm that moves across the paper on which the diagram or graph needs to be drawn. A pen moves along the arm and the arm itself moves relative to the paper. A combination of two, this provides movement along the horizontal and vertical axis. Now there are a number of different types of plotter. One is drum plotter, another one is flat bed plotter. This is a picture of a drum plotter. As you can see, it is having this arm and it is big in size. Now it draws on paper wrapped around the drum, which turns to produce one direction of the plot while the pens move to provide the other direction. In this plotter, the pen moves in the horizontally and the drum rolls on the other axis. So generally it is a graphical output device and it is generally used to plot drawings. It is very good for line drawing, but it is very slow. Here the pen moves in x axis and the paper moves in y axis. Now this is the example of flat bed plotters. This is a plotter where the paper is fixed on a flat surface and pens are moved to draw the image. This plotter can use several different colors, as you can see here, to draw with. The size of the plot is limited only by the size of the plotter bed. So this is all about our input and output devices. Thank you.